This week on Bad Things in History, diabetes. Until the 1920s, a diagnosis of type 1 diabetes meant slow and excruciating death. At first, the patient would start losing weight. This was usually followed by extreme thirst and then frequent and excessive urination. Overwhelming hunger was another symptom, and diabetes sufferers might start consuming food in incredible amounts. Doctors throughout the centuries had some treatments to delay the progression, but they couldn't cure it. Until the discovery of insulin, the only future for these patients was suffering and death. And by the time death arrived, it was usually a welcome relief. Eventually, it ended the same way for all of them. The body could not use carbohydrates, and weight loss progressed at a rapid pace. As the high levels of glucose in the blood continued to rise, it started to make the blood more acidic. At a certain point, the patient would no longer be able to breathe and would begin gasping for air. As the gasping began, the patient also began secreting proteins called ketones. These have a distinct sweet odor, much like nail polish remover. As these continued to build in the bloodstream, they affected everything. It started with breathing difficulties, then progressed to organ failure. By the end stages, the sickly sweet aroma was everywhere. At some point before death arrived, the patient would fall into a coma if they were lucky. For others, the intense suffering may be felt until nearly the last moment. The medical term for this condition is known today as diabetic ketoacidosis. Before 1922, every person that experienced diabetic ketoacidosis died, and nearly every person diagnosed with type 1 diabetes experienced it before the end. The ones who avoided it often died from other complications, such as infections that invaded their malnourished bodies. The discovery of insulin was a miracle for those that were suffering with this disease, and one of the first patients to receive insulin should have been dead long before it was available to treat her. Elizabeth Hughes was born in New York in 1907. Her father was Charles Evan Hughes, the governor of New York at the time. In 1918, at the age of 11, Elizabeth developed diabetes. The life expectancy for a diabetic at the time was usually a few weeks, or at most months. There was no effective treatment for type 1 diabetes, or diabetes mellitus, as the doctors called it when Elizabeth received her diagnosis. The only hope was that maybe she could be kept alive long enough for researchers to find a cure. This strategy had never worked for anyone else, but Elizabeth's parents had to try. It was the only hope they had. Elizabeth was sent to Dr. Frederick Allen in New Jersey in the spring of 1919. Through his research, he had confirmed that a starvation diet could keep diabetics alive longer than other treatment options. He had developed tests to determine how much a patient could consume before it caused problems. The patient would stop eating until no glucose was detected in the urine. Then, Allen would reintroduce food until glucose appeared again. The amount of food a patient could eat without having glucose show up in the urine usually became the diet plan a person had to follow for the rest of his or her life. Dr. Allen's tests indicated that Elizabeth could handle 800 calories a day. At the time she was diagnosed, she weighed 75 pounds. Elizabeth managed to survive on this strict diet for 3 years. By August 1922, she weighed only 45 pounds. It was obvious the starvation strategy wouldn't work much longer. In spring of 1922, insulin became available. Elizabeth's parents sent her to Toronto to see Frederick Banting, who began giving her injections. After receiving insulin, she started a 2,200 calorie per day diet and quickly gained weight. Elizabeth returned to school in 1923 and graduated from college in 1929. She survived with diabetes for 58 years. Her battle finally ended because of a heart attack in 1981. Elizabeth was 73 years old. I'm going to take this moment to beg you to leave us some comments, thumb up the video, watch the whole video, subscribe to the channel. Things like this really help small, invisible channels like ours to survive. Now, back to diabetes. Today we know that there are two main types of diabetes, and we know what causes them. Type 1 diabetes is usually the result of an immune condition. The pancreas is damaged by the immune system and can no longer produce insulin. The only way to treat this condition is with insulin injections. The other type, commonly called type 2, is related to insulin resistance. It usually, but not always, occurs in older people who are overweight. It can be treated with some medications, but can also be controlled with exercise and diet. Injections are usually not required as the patient's bodies still produce insulin. Doctors have been able to diagnose diabetes for much longer than they have been able to treat it. The first time symptoms of diabetes were recorded was in Egypt in 1552 BC. An Egyptian physician, Hesira, noted that people with this affliction experienced frequent urination. Eventually, they also lost weight and became emaciated. Hesira and other ancient physicians also noted that ants seemed to be attracted to the urine of the patients. The term diabetes, which we still use today, came from a Greek physician. In 150 AD, Herodias described diabetes as the melting down of limbs and flesh into urine. Although he didn't know the actual causes, it was a fairly accurate observation. Physicians continued to use sugar in urine as their primary diagnostic tool for centuries. Some doctors, such as those in Europe in the 1600s, would even drink patients' urine. If it contained sugar, they could taste it. It was an unappealing, if effective, way to identify sufferers of the disease. Doctors in the 1700s and 1800s began to realize that dietary changes could extend the life of diabetes patients. But since they didn't understand the cause of the disease, some of the treatments either did nothing or accelerated the progression of the disease. Some doctors would prescribe a mix of herbs or other substances intended to treat the diabetes. These usually had no effect at all. The worst treatment was when doctors would suggest patients should eat as much as possible. Since patients were losing weight and essentially starving to death, doctors thought that if patients could eat an incredible amount of calories, maybe they could delay the disease progression. Some even prescribed eating pure sugar as a treatment. Unlucky patients who adopted this strategy died within days or weeks. Researchers came close to understanding the cause of diabetes a few times. In 1683, one experimenter removed the pancreas from a dog. The resulting symptoms were recorded, but the researcher didn't make an association with diabetes. It would take about 200 more years for this to be rediscovered. One of the main problems is that early physicians assumed the stomach was the only organ involved in processing food. Clues that pointed in another direction were too often ignored. Still, in 1788, Thomas Cawley published a case study in the London Medical Journal that described an autopsy performed on a diabetic patient. He noted significant damage to the pancreas. Other autopsies were performed with similar discoveries all the way until the late 19th century. In terms of treatment before insulin was available, the starvation diet approach was the only effective option. Although it was known to work by some doctors in ancient times, its effectiveness was rediscovered in the early 1870s. A war between France and Prussia occurred during the early part of the decade, and food was rationed because of the war effort. A French physician, Apolline Bouchardin, observed that his diabetic patients had some of their symptoms improved during the conflict. He began developing individual diets to help diabetic patients. Of course, people don't like starving to death, especially over long periods of time. So some patients on the starvation diet plan would have to be restrained to keep them from eating more than was allowed. The treatment was almost as cruel as the disease. In 1889, researchers began experimenting on dogs again. This time, when they caused diabetes by removing the pancreas, it was understood that the pancreas was producing something essential. The path to discovering causes of diabetes and effective treatments was not simple, and it didn't happen quickly. At least 400 different individuals made contributions between the 18th and 20th centuries that were essential to creating treatments. Frederick Banting was the doctor who finally found a way to keep diabetic patients alive and healthy. He found a way to extract insulin from dogs' pancreases. Very quickly, he found that it wouldn't be possible to generate enough insulin this way and found a method to also extract it from cows and pigs. He began treating patients in 1922, including Elizabeth Hughes. Insulin extracted from animals would be the standard treatment until the 1980s. Although insulin from pigs and cows kept diabetics alive longer, most of them still died from complications years before otherwise healthy people. The technology did not exist to precisely determine glucose levels, nor was it possible to determine the insulin dose accurately. Many diabetic patients were kept alive for the immediate future, but their disease was still poorly controlled. Some of the symptoms of poorly controlled diabetes include kidney failure, blindness, failure of wounds to heal, and in the worst case, limb amputations. The relative frequency of these symptoms was much greater during the early days of insulin therapy. Starting in the 1940s, test strips were developed to help determine glucose levels. The diabetic patient would have to apply urine to the strip, and the strip would change color. The color would then indicate a glucose range. It wasn't very accurate, but it was certainly better than nothing. Delivery of insulin also has to be by injection, and that is mostly still true today. The injection has to be subcutaneous, meaning that it isn't necessary to inject it into a vein, but simply beneath the skin. Early syringes were made of glass and were very difficult to use. They would be boiled for sterilization purposes and were reused again and again. At the end of the 1960s, technology began to improve treatment options. First, the development of the HbA1c blood test helped with managing glucose levels. It provided an accurate average of glucose levels for the previous 3 months. Thus, it was possible for doctors to accurately determine how a patient was managing their glucose levels over time. In the 1970s, electronic glucose monitors became available, and smaller disposable syringes were manufactured for the first time. So, diabetic patients could determine their glucose with accuracy and also respond with accurate doses of insulin. Most importantly, the new syringes were less painful and did less damage to the skin. In the 1980s, even more improvements were made. Rather than continue offering animal insulin, human analog insulin was developed. It essentially used genetically modified bacteria to secrete the human insulin. This type of insulin is still used today. The cost to purchase it has grown astronomically over the last 35 years. If you want to know more about why that happened, then we suggest a previous episode on the history of healthcare. The methods of delivering insulin also improved. During the 1980s and 1990s, the development of insulin pumps provided yet another option. These devices deliver insulin via a tube inserted under the skin at a constant rate. It is able to mimic the function of a human pancreas more accurately than other treatment options. Additionally, there are options other than injection now as well. A type of insulin that can be inhaled was first developed in 2006, and other brands are available today. So far, they have not been able to replace injectable insulin. The reasons are varied, but side effects and dosage requirements are the main concerns. It's just easier to deal with injectable insulin, essentially. Some unlucky diabetics are still unable to control the condition with modern insulin. For them, the only solution might be a pancreas transplant. Patients that undergo this procedure can survive for several years without insulin. Eventually, though, the immune system that attacked the original pancreas attacks the new one as well. Nobody with type 1 diabetes has ever been permanently cured. For diabetics who can afford it, monitoring glucose is very easy using modern tools. Glucose meters that require a blood sample are cheap and affordable. Although more costly, there are also glucose monitors that are inserted into the skin and constantly monitor glucose levels. Diabetics in the 21st century have a variety of options to manage their glucose. Most healthy people have blood glucose in a range between 80 milligrams per deciliter and 120 milligrams per deciliter. Diabetic patients try to stay in that range as much as possible. At least the ones who want to live a long and healthy life do. So, How long can a person with diabetes today expect to live? That question is difficult to answer given that many improvements in treatment have happened within just the past 20 years. A Scottish study in 2015 attempted to answer this question mostly by using medical records covering the previous decade. They found that a person with type 1 diabetes on average can expect a 20-year decrease in life expectancy. That number can be reduced for those with excellent control or dramatically increased for patients who don't manage the disease well. As of 2019, the oldest living diabetic was a man named Don Ray, who currently lives in Cleveland, Ohio. He turned 85 years old that year and lived with type 1 diabetes for over 80 years. He was diagnosed in 1939 and says the reason he is still alive today is because of his excellent control. He was very meticulous about what he ate and how much, but especially during the years that it wasn't possible to know glucose levels. If Don Ray can survive, then there is certainly hope for patients today with diabetes that want to live long lives. Some people with the disease will unfortunately not follow a proper treatment plan. For these people, the death sentence that awaited diabetics prior to 1922 might be their fate as well. As of 2019, nearly 463 million people around the world depend on insulin to survive. If insulin production ever stops, they will all die very quickly. Though not quickly enough considering the suffering involved. But if modern industry fails and insulin stops being produced, it isn't all bad news. Starvation in the early days of the apocalypse should not be an issue because the survivors will have diabetic corpses to eat. How do you feel about diabetes? Are you happy that we have a way to treat it? Or are you frustrated that we don't have a cure? It is our sincere hope that you and those you care about are healthy and well this week. Thanks, as always, for watching Bad Things in History.